For the first time in 2015, Art Briles leads his team into McLean Stadium. They call it the Bear Walk. However, walking, not a requirement for this team. It is a beautiful evening on the Brazos River here in Waco, where temperatures are in the upper 70s and where this jewel sits. And where back-to-back Big 12 champions have never lost. The Baylor line, one of the great traditions in college football, is the class of 2019 out there to welcome this team onto the field at McLean Stadium, where tonight the number 4 team in the nation, the Baylor Bears, welcome the Lamar Cardinals for the first home game of what these fans hope will be a national championship season. Along with former NFL linebacker Ben Lieber, I am Brendan Burke. Well, this Baylor offense has led the nation in back-to-back seasons. Last week, 723 more yards. Ben, I think we're getting an idea of what this offense is capable of.
This offense is unbelievable. Led by 3 dynamic wide receivers, and they produced against everybody. Last year against Michigan State, 41 points. TCU, 61 points. They do it against average defenses. They do it against great defenses. But to me, the real story for this year, if they want to be a championship-level team, their defense has to step up. No more shootouts. They have to step up and dominate teams when they need to dominate. Don't rely on the offense to score more points.
While Baylor's defense wasn't impressive last week against SMU, they were missing 2 big pieces. They get them both back, and none bigger than the big man, Sean Oakman.
Yeah, Sean Oakman, everybody knows he's the most intimidating guy in college football. I get all that. But he brings a passion and an energy to this team, and they sorely lacked it last week. They need more discipline out of him. Quarterback got out on the edge too much against SMU. Hopefully he can come out with his presence and shut down the running game for Lamar.
Baylor's defense will no doubt be looking to make a statement against Lamar, and the offense will be on full display here in the home opener against Lamar for the number 4 team in the land, the Baylor Bears. We're closing in on kickoff here in Waco. It's coming your way next. This is a $262 million facility that opened in 2014. They sold the place out in every game last year, and they won every game here last year. Brendan Burke, Ben Lieber, will hear from Christian Steckel in just a few moments. And it is may not be the first game of the season overall, but it is the first game here in Waco this year, and they are excited. The atmosphere is electric. As you take a look at Ryan Woodard, in his 6th season as the head coach of the Lamar Cardinals, he has been the head coach ever since they resurrected the program in 2010. On the opposite sideline, the 59-year-old Art Briles in his 8th season at Baylor, 55 wins so far in his first 7 seasons heading into this year, the 2013 Big 12 Coach of the Year. Lamar won the toss and elected to receive, so they will start with the football as Spencer Evans will do the honors of kicking this one away and getting our game underway here in Waco. Rodney Randall is back to receive for Lamar. Just a couple of kick returns. Lamar had a big week last week in a 66-3 win over Bacon College, an NAIA school from Muskogee, Oklahoma. Baylor, well, they put up 56 points in a 56-21 win over SMU on the road last Friday night. This one is in Randall's direction, but he will watch it go out the back of the end zone. And Lamar will start on the 25-yard line. And Ben, we get right into it. Who are we watching when Lamar has the ball?
Well, with Lamar, the coaches really think they have an NFL caliber receiver. And Reggie Begelton, I'm looking to him early and often. And Carson Earp, one of 2 quarterbacks you're going to see tonight. He's the running quarterback. Baylor's defense got hurt last week against SMU.
Number 12, 5-yard penalty, first down.
Baylor's defense got hurt last week against SMU with a running quarterback. So you're going to see a lot of Carson Earp. Runs that zone read perfectly. Andrew Billings on defense, one of the best and strongest defensive players in the Big 12. And Orion Stewart suspended last week. They really missed his tenacity and what he brings. He's the quarterback of this defense. He'll make a lot of plays tonight as well.
Well, there's a quarterback competition ongoing with Lamar. Joe Minden and Carson Earp are the 2 candidates. It is Carson Earp to start today as he hands the ball to Cade Harrington and gets just a couple on first down. Middle linebacker Grant Campbell on the tackle. Last week, Joe Minden made the start. This week, it is Carson Earp. They are expecting them both to play a quarter in the first half and then keep the hot hand in the rest of the way. But 5 for 6 for the couple of touchdowns and 91 yards. Not a bad way to start, or at least put your name into the hat to become the starting quarterback for Lamar. They put Harrington in motion, and he wasn't ready for the snap, and he is able to pick it up and scramble, took a hard hit and threw it out of bounds. That could have been a whole lot worse for Lamar, as Carson Earth just not ready for that ball to come his way from the center, Matthew Ubrey.
Well, clearly just some miscommunication with the center and the offensive line. I think the whole offense knew the ball was going to be snapped, but I don't think Earth was ready for it. You know, obviously a lot of jitters. For some of these players, this is the biggest stadium and the largest crowd they've ever played against, so clearly there's some nerves.
So third and 8 after the incomplete. First third down, you hear the Baylor line. Seated in the first 13 rows behind the visitor's bench, start to make some noise. On the option. Dragged down by Andrew Billings. A loss of 1. And a punt coming for Lamar.
Well, you're going to see Sean Oakman's presence being felt right away. He's right here, the right defensive end. He gets up the field on this read option. And look at him just blast the offensive tackle, taking away any sort of pitch opportunity that Earp was going to have. That's the thing that they missed last week, is that tenacity and that length that Sean Oakman has.
Juan Caronco will put it in the direction of Corey Coleman, who will let it bounce. It comes right to him. And he spins away from the first would-be tackle. Earp was able to get a few yards on it as we go down to the sidelines and introduce you to Christian Steckel. Christian?
Well, guys, tonight Baylor has suspended offensive coordinator Kendall Briles and wide receivers coach Tate Wallace because they were found to find NCAA regulations, and they had a suspension based upon getting into the spring game and not talking to kids when they should. Jeff Levy will be the tight end coach. Normally, he's calling the play tonight up in the booth. Guys, back to you.
Well, thank you, Christian. You see Jeff Levy, who is upstairs in his normal spot where he works during the games, normally as the passing game coordinator, running backs coach, but he has the extra responsibility of calling the plays tonight. Although Kendall Briles had only called the plays for 2 games, the first game last week and the last game last year in the Cotton Bowl against Michigan State. First pass is to a wide open Jay Lee as Seth Russell completes for the first down, a 14-yard gain on the very first play for this Baylor offense.
And right away, what does Jeff Levy do? He sticks big number 80 Laquan McGowan, the 410-pound tight end in the backfield, kind of threw everybody off on defense.
3 receivers lined up on the top, and they blow this one dead. Flag comes out.
False start. Offense. All 11 players were not set prior to the snap. 5-yard penalty. First down.
The referee Dan Romeo, and that's the issue you get with a quick, up-tempo offense.
Well, you're going to see, I'm going to make this circle really, really big for him. McGowan, like I said, he's 6'7", 410 pounds. You see that big guy in the backfield? Everybody in the front seven's keyed in for some sort of run play, and they pass.
Devin Chaffin on the carry. He's able to get back about a yard past the original line of scrimmage. Bring up 2nd and 9. Penalties were a problem last year for Baylor. They were a problem last week for Baylor. 13 penalties last week, 105 yards. 10 of them were the offense being the issue, as the pass is complete to Jay Lee, who picked up 4. It'll bring up 3rd down. Lloyd Julian on the tackle. Jay Lee last week had 3 catches. They were all touchdowns. Here he's got the first 2 catches in the first handful of plays. He's yet to get on the board. Not sure what's taking him so long. On 3rd and 4, the pass floated out there. There is a flag on the play as Katie Cannon avoids a tackler and will get into the end zone. It'll be a 48-yard touchdown if it stands. The flag is back at the 43-yard line.
An eligible receiver downfield, number 80, was covered up by an outside receiver, making him ineligible. 5-yard penalty, 3rd down.
Well, and they bring big number 80 across the field in motion. You'll see him in motion right here. He's going to wiggle over here in motion. You have to step off the line and not cover him up. So right now, when he sets on the line of scrimmage, he's now a covered up player. He cannot go out for a pass play, and that's what they got him on.
Now, Laquan McGowan is not naturally a tight end. Until the last game of last season, he had never been used as a tight end. But this year, he is the biggest tight end you can find. Russell with time, and he hits Jay Lee, and he has himself a first down. Lloyd Julian made the tackle, and it has been the Jay Lee show here on the opening possession for Baylor.
Well, you can see right away what Craig McGallion, the defensive coordinator for Lamar, doesn't want any big shots over the top, so he's playing a really soft zone to try to keep everything in front.
Jacques Linwood finds a gap and gets five before he's run into by Larry Carroll, junior transfer from Kilmore College. As we'll see, Baylor mix it up between the run and the pass. So Shock Linwood, Devin Chafin, even guys like Johnny Jefferson, Terrence Williams, getting some carries here today. Pass complete over on the far side to Davion Hall. Couldn't reach. He'll be about a yard short on third down.
You know, so you see right there, making first contact and actually getting the receiver on the ground. That's what makes it so tough against these guys. They break a lot of tackles because guys don't realize until they get on the field how big and strong these receivers are.
Off the right side, he's got the first down. Tommy Barrett on the tackle, but a 7-yard gain. The first team all Big 12 running back from a year ago. Over 1,200 yards, 16 touchdowns on 251 carries. Russell looking end zone. A little miscommunication there with Corey Coleman. Seth Ellis in coverage on Coleman.
Well, you can already see, too, Lamar's defense not used to the tempo. Not a lot of guys lined up, just some miscommunication there. Coleman thought it was just going to be an inside post route. Russell thought it was going to be an outside flag or deep seven route. He just wasn't there.
Gowan is in as a blocker as they throw a quick pass to Lee. Able to adjust, come back, and make the catch. What a grab by Lee as the pass thrown a little bit behind him.
I see on this drive right here, just seeing the sheer athleticism. That was a tough catch, back shoulder throw. Receiver has to turn his body with great concentration, and he does that.
Another catch for Jay Lee on the 10th play of the drive, and he's down inside the two.
What's that you said? Baylor's running 10 plays on this one
How
drive?
How about that? This will be the 11th. Linwood met head on, trying to keep the legs moving. Touchdown! First touchdown of the season for Shock Linwood. Chris Callahan comes out to punch the extra point through. As Baylor takes 11 plays to methodically march down the field. An efficient Seth Russell was 6-for-7 on the drive. And Shock Linwood able to cap it off on his third carry of the opening possession. And Callahan has no problem with the extra point. Well, we knew what Baylor's offense was capable of. They went to the air, but didn't necessarily air it out down the field. Short passes, but complete passes. And Baylor comes all the way down the field. Shock Lynn with the touchdown. The Bears have a 7-0 lead after one touch of the football. Shock Linwood punched it in at the end, but it was an 11-play, 67-yard drive. And it felt like it took forever watching Baylor. It took 2 minutes and 50 seconds, which is forever when you're talking about this Baylor offense.
Well, what did the word use? Methodical? That's just not in Baylor's DNA to be methodical. You know, I actually like the approach that Lamar's taking. Deeper zone coverages, keep everything in front, no big plays over the top.
Rodney Randall will think better of it from the back of the end zone and the second straight touchback. And another flag on the play. We had one after Baylor's first kickoff, and we have another one here after their second. We'll get to hear from Dan Romeo again.
Personal foul. Illegal block below the waist. Receiving team, number 28. After this is the goal. First down.
Zach Johnson from Lamar. We'll back them up a little bit. Things like that are not going to make Ray Woodard very happy. As the defense for Baylor comes back on the field, so does Sean Oakman, who may have something to prove this week after being suspended for the opening game against SMU.
Well, he has something to prove not only this game, but he has something to prove really throughout the whole season. I think there's a lot to be made of just his size and stature at 6'9", 275, certainly an intimidating, really, really good player. But he needs to refine some skills. If he wants to be a dominating defensive end that wants to be taken high in the NFL draft, he's got to develop some more pass rushing moves and play the run a little bit better. But right now he's got a great foundation to be one heck of an athlete and one heck of a player.
Lamar went three and out on their first possession. Empty backfield here as Ertz fires to the sideline. And that's his running back, Cade Harrington, out there making the catch. Avion Edwards on the tackle as Edwards getting the start at linebacker today, replacing Taylor Young, who was out with a sprained shoulder. They say Young could have played, but decided this is a long season. We're going to sit him out here today.
Well, and I've played with some of those AC sprains in your shoulders, and they're not easy to play through. And because, you know, let's be honest, this is Lamar. They should beat these guys. That this is a good chance for him to get healthy.
Second and seven, Harrington to the outside. He gets run into by Xavier Howard and knocked out of bounds after just a couple of yards. It'll bring up third down.
Well, one thing that we need to be tracking throughout this game, and I know Phil Bennett's going to be tracking this, is after last week, they only had a few opportunities to tackle during training camp, and it was evident last week against SMU, a lot of missed tackles, something he wants to watch these guys. We're going to be simple. We're going to be fundamentally sound. I want to see my guys fly around and make some tackles on first contact.
Baylor's defense looked extremely different in the second half than they did in the first half last week, shutting out SMU in the second half. But the pass is complete to Michael Handy, who lunges forward, and he picks up the first down. First down here for Lamar. And a nice tackle made by Ryan Reed.
Well, this is what I'm talking about. 3-on-1, you're out on an island, there's nobody else, you can't leverage the ball for any other help. You have to make that tackle. It's going to be a bigger gain. It's not a pretty tackle, but he got him down.
Carson Earp went 5-for-6 last week. He's transferred in from Navarro Junior College. Lamar, coming into the season, was left with no quarterbacks on their roster that had ever taken a snap for their school. A three-man competition as Earp has the ability to run, and he's going to show it off here. He's got one guy to beat to the outside, but a nice job by Ryan Reed to knock him out of bounds. Otherwise, he was gone. Picked up 12 on the play.
Well, this is the zone read that he's so good at. Watch it, Grant Campbell, the linebacker. He's got to be responsible to be outside. See, all the gaps inside are taken. Grant has to realize when he's got that slanting defensive line, there's no gaps inside for him. He has to get outside. That's a problem for last week against SMU.
Earp to pass on first down. Slings it over to an open DeAndre Jennings, and Jennings is wrestled out of bounds by Terrell Burt. But another first down after 11 yards. Carson Earp is the more mobile of the two passers. We'll see Joe Minden in the second quarter, but Earp, he's looked pretty good. And a mobile passer, Ben, in a game like this where you would expect some pressure on the quarterback from Baylor, that may be his best attribute when it comes to this game. Cade Harrington with Earp in the backfield. Keep it. And he's got a huge hole in the middle. Earp tracked down from behind. He's inside the 30. Orion Stewart with a touchdown saving tackle.
Well, once again, it's everybody on the back side of this defense. Here's the zone read. Everybody's going to be flowing this way. You have to have somebody backside. Jamal Palmer, number 92, the left defensive end. Your leverage is outside, so stay outside. Don't get nosy. Your responsibility is outside.
That was a 25-yard run by Carson Earp, who had three rushes for 36 yards all last week in their 66-3 win over Bacone College. This time he will hand it off to Emmett Raleigh, one of the many options in the Lamar backfield. 3-yard pickup, Jamal Palmer on the tackle.
Well, this is exactly what happened last week again at SMU. Not just the running game, but what it allows this team to do is get some hope, get some belief that they can play with this Baylor Bear defense.
Lamar University is out of the Southland Conference. They have a huge game next week against Sam Houston State for their season. I feel like their preparation and game against Baylor here today will do them wonders for that game. Earp on the rollout, pumps twice, and then feeds one through. A nice grab by Jace Nelson over near the sideline. First down after a 13-yard gain.
That, to me, was an impressive play because we talked about Carson just running the football. That's what he's really good at. But they call sprint action out to the right, get some extra blockers, get away from this aggressive defensive line, and he delivers a strike. He was accurate on the run.
This is the ninth play of the drive for Lamar, who has come right back down the field answering Baylor's touchdown drive. And now have first and 10 from the Baylor 12. The handoff goes to Harrington. He has a tough time just getting back to the line of scrimmage. Big Andrew Billings was there to make the tackle. Who has now posted at least one tackle in all 26 games of his career.
Well, this is a little bit on talk out of both sides of my mouth. Is sometimes to stop this running game, you just have to penetrate, but you have to do it with a little bit of tempo so you don't cause some creases. And that time, the whole defensive front collectively is able to shoot the gaps, get upfield, cause the running back to stutter his feet, get a tackle for loss. So they can keep doing that without causing some extra gaps. They'll be successful against the zone read.
Earp on second and 9, hands it off, and Cade Harrington has scored for Lamar. The junior running back slipped right through Javal Palmer, and Lamar an extra point away from tying the game.
Well, once again, it's tackles. Look at, everybody has a gap. Stay in your gap. Responsibilities are drawn up. Play gets there. And Palmer just doesn't squeeze down as a defensive end. So one time, he goes inside on the drive. Quarterback goes outside. This time, he stays too far upfield, like just like I was talking about. You go too far upfield and not play with tempo, you can crease yourself.
Alex Ball for the extra point. It is good. And Lamar looks pretty good marching down the field against Baylor's defense. Cade Harrington gets them into the end zone. And Lamar has come back and even the score with Baylor here in the first quarter. During SUV season with incredible savings only at your Texas Ford dealer. Ford is the best in Texas. It's not bad when you start a pep rally at your school and you wind up with a Brad Paisley concert. Part of the university's annual traditions rally, but a free concert of the first 10,000 students in attendance for Brad Paisley on his Country Nation College Tour. What a bad night. 10,000.
10,000.
And then the captain.
Well, and then we saw that picture about 2 hours before, and it was packed 2 hours before the concert.
How about the drive from Lamar? 10 plays, 87 yards. You see that it took 5 minutes and 14 seconds. Carson Earp went 4 for 4 for 32 yards, also rushed the ball for 37 yards on that drive alone.
Their game plan is working out perfectly. Defensively, they wanted Baylor to earn every single yard. Deeper zones, throw the ball in front. Offensively, they wanted to slow it down, run the football. So far, Lamar is doing everything right.
Ishmael Zamora is going to take it out after he dropped it, and he only gets to the 10-yard line. Zach Johnson on the tackle on a sloppy play from the Baylor return game, and Ishmael Zamora. Not sure if he thought that he had to take it out as he dropped it right along the goal line. So poor field position for Baylor. When we come back, we'll see if the offense can restore the energy to McLean Stadium here in Waco. Go out there and get yourself on TV. Make a play that they're going to replay a couple of times. Get yourself on a highlight show. This is the biggest stage they're going to play on. Sean Jones has made the first such play.
It's the biggest stage, and like I said earlier, they have nothing to lose. Nobody's expecting these guys to come in to Waco and beat the Baylor Bears. And right now, we're in the first quarter, and we have a game.
less than 3 minutes remaining in the first quarter. Carson Earp, who has been outstanding, is the quarterback for the Lamar Cardinals. And a bad snap. He's able to pick it up, wants to throw, and he just throws this one way over everybody's head. His left tackle, Cody Ahlen's, got knocked down and his helmet came off on the play. He'll have to leave the field. That's the second time so far today we've seen a tough quarterback-center exchange between Matthew Oubre and Carson Earp.
Well, and it was at least smart by Earp just get rid of the football. Don't try to make something out of nothing. Don't try to be a hero. You're in this football game right now. Just play another down.
For the second and 10 play.
Clock operator, please reset the clock to 2:43.
I have an issue with the game clock. 6 seconds need to be put back on the game clock to 2:43. They quickly get that adjusted, as Art Briles cannot be all that happy right now with his offense nor his defense on back-to-back possessions. And we're not going to get this second and 10 off either.
False start. Offense, number 84, 5-yard penalty, second down.
Penalties on the tight end, DeAndre Jennings. And it'll make it second and 15 instead. Cody Ahlen's, their starting left tackle after losing his helmet, is back on the field now. Earp on the move. As an open receiver, and the catch is made. 7-yard pickup for Devin Brown. Could have been more had the pass been a little bit more towards his chest than his feet.
That's a long throw out there from the left hash all the way out to the number one receiver on the numbers. I'm sure he'd want that one back because he had some room for Brown to run. A big third down stop here. If Baylor can step up after that big drive that they had on that last series, they need to have a big play right here on third down.
On third and 8, Earth got hit and it's incomplete. He took a shot and was trying to get the ball out to Reggie Bagleton, but Sean Oakman, Jamal Palmer made that very difficult for Earth.
Well, that was about the most positive play this defense has had so far. Just a 4-man rush. You're asking your guys, just beat the guy in front of you. We don't need to bring an extra blitzer, an extra guy in the attack. Mano a mano, those guys all beat their guy in front of them and got to the quarterback.
Lynx Hawthorne is back for Baylor at his own 20. He will get away from it. The ball will kick out of bounds. Let's go to Jenny Taft in Los Angeles for our first game break. Jenny?
Brendan, thanks so much. An upset in the SEC. Number 18, Arkansas, trailing Toledo with 1 second to play. Brandon Allen, he scrambles, can't find anyone. Toledo pulls off the upset, 16-12 in Arkansas. Brendan, Ben, back to you guys.
Thank you, Jenny.
Wow,
here in Waco, we've got ourselves a football game.
And there's a lot of people that thought that Arkansas was a team that was going to turn that corner in the SEC and really make some noise. It's a devastating loss to Toledo for Arkansas.
How about the SEC having Auburn narrowly escape in overtime today against an FCS opponent? Heads are being turned here today. Pass is complete, and slipping away is Corey Coleman. Can't get completely free, but does have a big gain. Xavier Bethany on the stump, but a 20-yard pickup for Corey Coleman.
Well, now we might see this Baylor offense start to open things up. Ran the football a little bit these last two series. Now they play action trying to get Corey Coleman involved.
Russell, Jay Lee, another grab, another first down. He's into Lamar territory, picking on Rodney Randall that time. 8th catch of the football game for Jay Lee.
Well, that's what makes this Baylor offense so tough. Corey Coleman, Jay Lee, KD Cannon. You just don't have enough skill guys on defense to match up with them.
Taking a shot down the sideline. His nickname is Superman, and he looked the part. Corey Coleman on the touchdown.
I am literally in awe right now. That pass was so on the money from the right hash all the way across the field with the speed of Corey Coleman. You can't deliver a better ball. That was a great catch, but my goodness, was that just a very, very beautiful play. I can't get over how pretty that pass was.
Ray Woodard, the head coach for Lamar, is out onto the field talking to the officials. I think he's at least wanting it entertained that they look at it again, but that was a catch. As we've taken a couple looks at it here, that's the 10th career touchdown reception of Corey Coleman of 30-plus yards. Take another look at the diving grab by Coleman. He got that arm underneath him.
Yeah, I think he got the left arm underneath. Had he not, and the ball hit the ground, if the ball causes it to move a little bit, then maybe you have a case, but I think this is going to be a touchdown. And it is.
So Callahan out for Baylor. And a bad snap. And trying to make something out of it was the holder, Cole Edmiston, but they're going to cost themselves a point there. Not the greatest snap by Jimmy Landis. And so Baylor's lead is just 6 after the touchdown between Seth Russell and Corey Coleman. I wouldn't mind watching this one a few more times.
Well, they get man-to-man up top. They decide to man everybody up, and you just see the 6'3", 220-pound junior and Seth Russell just deliver that football. And again, a lot of distance, a lot of accuracy, and a lot of touch. Just think about how he's got to calculate that speed of Corey Coleman going down the sidelines and delivers it exactly where he needs to. So here we are. We're going to see the matchup right there, man-to-man. Across the field, you get a safety sitting in the middle of the field, and it's just straight speed. Here's a 4-3-8 guy, and I don't care who you are as a corner, if you don't get a little bit of bump, disrupt that route a little bit at 4-3-8, he's going to win that matchup every time. And again, Seth Russell delivering just a perfect ball to Corey Coleman.
That's one of the things that the Lamar coaching staff talked about to us. The hardest thing to prepare for with Baylor is their speed. They don't have anyone on the scout team that runs a 4-2-5. Rodney Randall, he runs pretty well. His speed gets him across the 30, out to the 33-yard line. The tackle was made by Teon Sells, a 32-yard return by the true freshman Rodney Randall, whose speed got the coach's attention, and he worked himself into the 2-deep and is their main returner.
Well, you said it earlier, this is one of the challenges that Lamar had during practice. How do we match the speed of Baylor on scout team? We don't have enough guys. We have a few fast guys here and there, but nobody can compare with the track athletes they have at the receiver position. Defensively, how do you match up with the size and the strength of this Baylor defensive line? You just can't do it. So these guys have done a really nice job of settling into this football game and matching athleticism when they didn't get that in practice.
The handoff to Harrington, trying to knife through, but he got buried. Brian Nance. Right on him, dropped him for a loss of 1. Well, Carson Earp on one drive was able to lead his Lamar team down the field and punch it in and make it look relatively easy. But before that and after that, it has been a struggle for the Lamar Cardinals. 2nd and 11. He's got an open receiver. The catch is made by Michael Handy, but it didn't do him very much good. Ryan Reed with the tackle after just a 4-yard gain. 3rd and long coming up.
And that's a good sign for Baylor. We talked about the open field tackling that they had last week, the problems with it. That's twice now that Ryan Reed has been singled out on an island. He's made 2 really nice tackles.
What could be the last play of the first quarter coming up. If they even get it off. And I don't think they want to. With Baylor, sometimes your best defense is to keep the ball out of the hands of their offense, and why not let a few more seconds run off, and that'll be the end of our first quarter here. Lamar hanging with Baylor for the moment. But Baylor has flexed its offensive muscles just slightly here today. First quarter, they put up 13, but the lead is just 6 over the visiting FCS Lamar Cardinals. Fourth team in the country, Baylor up 13-7 over Lamar as we take a look at the stats for the first quarter. And the score might be the most surprising one, but there's the rest of them.
Well, the one I was looking at is the tackles for loss down at the bottom of your screen down here. Lamar has 2 TFLs to Baylor's 1. We talked about at the beginning of the show, if Baylor wants to take the next step to be a championship caliber team, they have to step up on defense and cause big plays. And so far, against Lamar, only 1 tackle for loss in the first quarter, not good enough.
Second quarter will start with a 3rd and 7 for Carson Earp and the Lamar offense. But they're going to run out of time. Delay of game.
How do you do that?
Delay of game. Offense. Number 11. 5-yard penalty. 3rd down.
And the body language from Carson Earp said he had no idea where the play clock was at when it expired. Just a shrug of the shoulders.
I wonder if it's one of those location things as he switches the side of the field. He did not locate the play clock and therefore didn't know how urgent he had to be, but you don't need to see that coming out of a break.
So instead of 3rd and 7, it is 3rd and 12. He's on the move. He's made a couple of nice throws in that position already, but this time he just throws it away. Took a shot from Jamal Palmer as well, and Lamar will be forced to punt.
Well, you're going to see this speed again by Baylor's defense. Jamal Palmer, I don't think, gets enough credit. We talk about Andrew Billings and Sean Oakman, Bo Blackshear being a very consistent player. But Jamal Palmer, a violent, violent player, plays with a nice motor. You see it right there as he gets to the edge and gets a quarterback hit.
It's the 3rd 3-and-out for Lamar, who have gone 3-and-out on every drive except for the one that scored a touchdown on Lynx Hawthorne with a fair catch on the tips of his fingers and then a little bit of contact afterwards, but they deem it incidental and no flag was thrown. Brett Nicholson was the one there to wrap him up after the fair catch. Well, we're going to get a little look at the wide receiving combo. Corey Coleman, Katie Cannon, the only team that's returning 2 1,000-yard receivers, the Baylor Bears. And they've got other options as well. Tonight, Jay Lee's been the number one option, but these two guys are special players.
Oh, they're special. I think everybody around this area, and even nationally, Katie Cannon coming out of high school is an All-American. They're hoping that he could transition that into the college level, and he has. I think the best thing about it is that the coaches understand that KD lives with Corey Coleman.
Russell just put the ball on the ground and Lamar jumps all over it. It'll be a question of whether or not he was down. They've ruled it Lamar football. As he was rotating onto his back in the air, the ball came free.
Rolling on the field was a fumble recovered by Lamar.
And it was the linebacker Logan Moss who got a piece of the Baylor quarterback, and then it was picked up by Omar Tebow.
Well, it's one of the few pure dropbacks that we saw, asking the offensive line to protect a little bit longer, and you see Logan Moss blitzing around the offensive right side, gets his hand in there, knocks it out, and big Omar Tebow, we talked about him, big explosive defensive tackle with the recovery, and now Lamar, change of field possession, get a turnover. It's great stuff if you're a Lamar Cardinal.
It is the second quarter, so Joe Minden's in the game. His first pass of the game is nearly picked off. Xavier Howard nearly had it. Brendan Langley had to turn into the defensive back there and knock it away from Howard.
Well, as a defensive player, we were always told after a turnover, expect the big play. Expect them to take a shot, and they did exactly that. They brought in Minden, who's more the pocket passer, to try to deliver a strike down the field.
Again, this is an ongoing quarterback competition for the Lamar Cardinals. Earp played the first quarter. Minden will play the second. The third is to be determined. They hand it off to Cade Harrington to the 20. And a first down before Trayvon Blanchard made the tackle. 16-yard pickup.
Well, we keep seeing these creases. Watch the defensive end. He has to close down the running lanes. He doesn't. He tried to feather it too much. They crease him up the middle. Right now, this read option has this Baylor defense confused on what their gap responsibilities are supposed to be.
It is Minden who got buried by Grant Campbell, ran right into him. Minden is more of the pocket passer, but they said don't sleep on him. He can run better than you think.
Yeah, and he has such a grasp of this offense that they're confident in his ability to do that. It's not out of the realm to see him run with the football.
He's a transfer from Stephen F. Austin. So the big environment isn't necessarily a shock to him. With SFA, he has played in some of the FBS stadiums, played in Kansas State last year. Minden on the move. Looking to the end zone. Not in, but the pass is complete. Catch made by Reggie Bagleton. They mark him down at the one.
And the thing I liked about that pass play was the timing of it. Again, getting their quarterbacks out on the edge. They're so fearful of this defensive line getting penetration. Got him out on the edge, and he threw that football before Bagleton got out of his break.
First and goal. All they need is one. Harrington. Touchdown. Almost 2 minutes in to the second quarter, and Lamar has tied it, an extra point away from leading the number four Baylor Bears.
Right now you can just see the shock and awe that's taking place right now on this Baylor sideline. Everybody is kind of milling around. Defense is kind of milling around. They're confused on defense against the zone read. They come out with Joe Minden, the pocket passer. He throws a strike down the field to Bagleton to set up the touchdown. And here we'll take a look at it again. Cade Harrington just finding a crease to the left side. They're trying to see if his right knee was down. It was down, but it looked like the football was across the plane.
So we'll take a couple of looks, make sure they get it right. Replay official Bob Wutek. It's in his hands. He says, Lamar touchdown. Alex Ball for the extra point. Right down the middle. The Lamar University Cardinals from Beaumont, Texas, lead the mighty Baylor Bears 14-13. Seth Russell put it on the ground. Cade Harrington put it in the end zone.
It's a football game. Guys are heated, emotionally back and forth.
Just a little shove there at the end, but this is Devin Chapin. 6 foot, 225 pounds, just barreling his way through.
I think if that's the infraction that they called him upon, I think, you know, at some point in time, you just have to let these guys play. This is a violent game where a lot of emotions are flowing through your body. That, to me, was not egregious in any way.
Another flag on this kickoff for Baylor. Let's go back to that play. This is later.
Kicking team. 5-yard penalty. First down.
That's where they got him.
Okay. All right, I agree with the referees on that one.
And so Ronnie Jones does get the 15-yard penalty in his first unsportsmanlike conduct infraction. Let's go back to that touchdown.
Well, you're going to see right here one of the best receivers in the game just go right down the field. And that's just an acrobatic catch, a little back shoulder, playing a soft zone. And that's just Seth Russell trusting the type of athlete that is out there.
First and 10 from the 30 after the Baylor penalty on the kickoff. Following a 9-play drive that went 79 yards for Baylor, capped off by the 21-yard touchdown catch by Corey Coleman. Hand off to Cade Harrington, and he gets 5 on first down. And Some more unsportsmanlike conduct penalties going to be handed out. This one's going against Baylor. Looks like Xavier Howard.
You know, I'm okay with some chippiness, just no dumb penalties.
And it's all been well after the play is over. This one as well.
There were fouls by both teams. Unsportsmanlike conduct, number 84, offense. Unsportsmanlike conduct, number 4, defense. Those fouls will offset. That's number 84's first unsportsmanlike conduct foul. And that's number 4, first unsportsmanlike foul call.
We need to get a running list of guys that have had their first warning. They get another one and they're ejected from this game.
There's 3 of them on the Lamar side and now 1 on the Baylor side. Xavier Howard, their starting quarterback. Meanwhile, back on the football field, 2nd and 5 coming up for Lamar from their own 35. Joe Minden didn't start the game, came in at the start of the second quarter. He's only thrown 2 passes, 1 complete for 17 yards. He'll hand it off to Harrington. Slips forward for a couple. Avion Edwards makes the stop, 3rd and 3. Baylor's been able to stop Lamar on 3 out of 4 third downs.
Some confusion right now with Baylor defense. Byron Bonds, number 96, just trying to get lined up. A lot of communication, a lot of guys talking.
Lamar's going to take the timeout. Lamar was looking to the sidelines. They couldn't get their play in either, so they elect for the timeout. Big third down coming here for Lamar, not to let momentum get away too much. They're down by 7. The ball on the Bears' 16-yard line. 2nd and 7 coming for Joe Minden and the Lamar Cardinals. In just their 6th season of a resurrected program. 0-5 against the FBS so far. Minden to the end zone. They're going to mark him just shy. Complete down to the half-yard line to Reggie Bagleton.
And it's Bagleton who set up the last touchdown. They're singled up on the outside, number 2 receiver. There's no deep safety in the middle of the field. He crosses his face. It's a nice throw and a great catch. So now here we are, sudden change, and Lamar is knocking on Baylor's touchdown or end zone right here.
From the 1, Harrington was the decoy. Sneaks in. They sold it. Baylor bites. And the Lamar Cardinals are down by 1 point with 4.5 minutes to go in the first half.
You can see the disgust on Phil Bennett's face. This zone read has been killing them these last 2 weeks. Everybody crashes down, not expecting the pocket passer to pull it and run. Great design. I think they fooled a lot of people in the stands.
Extra point is good, and we are tied. Number 4 Baylor. And FCS Lamar knotted at 21. It was a short drive because of the 2nd consecutive interception thrown by Seth Russell, who took over for Bryce Petty this year, one of the most accurate passers the Big 12 has ever seen. There's the pick on the miscommunication with Corey Coleman and an athletic grab by Seth Ellis, the senior from Coolidge, Arizona. And then look at the play fake.
I mean, everything that they're doing right now is working. They watched the film last week of SMU's Matt Davis, the quarterback, very dynamic quarterback. Hurt these guys, hurt this defense with the ends crashing down on the zone read. And right now, Lamar's offense is 3 for 3 in the red zone. when you need a defense to be dominant, to step up, to be a championship-style team, Lamar has the Baylor Bears on the ropes, 21-21 as we wind down this second quarter.
Now listen, not to oversell it, last week Baylor held SMU completely off the board in the second half. They beat them 56-21. But I think, Ben, no matter what the final score is of this game, people are going to have questions moving forward against Baylor and their defense.
Well, and I think it's a fair question.
It's a touchback. They're legends, icons, and warriors, and starting next month, two of the biggest names in the UFC will face off as coaches as interim featherweight champion Conor McGregor and Uriah Faber join an all-new season of The Ultimate Fighter. The mayhem continues Wednesday only on Fox Sports 1. It is a fair question at this point for Baylor, who that was their knock last season. We expected it to be better. Is it?
You know, right now, I don't think it is. You know, nobody would expect Lamar to be hanging in there with Baylor at all. And like we talked about, if they want to be a championship-style team, their defense has to step. It can't be these shootouts where you just expect the offense to put up one more point or two more points than the other team. Baylor defense has to step up. And this is an FCS school, and you need to do that. And they're not doing it tonight.
He connects with Corey Coleman, who just cannot get away. Forward progress will give him 4 yards, even though he was tackled back close to the line of scrimmage by Lloyd Julian.
Well, and the frustrating thing I think it has to be for Phil Bennett, the defensive coordinator for Baylor, is that they're getting beat with such simplistic plays. It's a zone read. Every team runs a zone read, but they can't figure out a way to stop it.
Here's a nice run by Johnny Jefferson, spun down at the 39-yard line. He got 10 and a first down. Rodney Randall saved the day with that tackle.
And Jefferson's sort of the lightning to this backfield where you see Linwood, a bigger guy, Chafin, a bigger guy. He's the quicker, more agile running back.
There's Corey Coleman again. They cannot catch him. 61 yards on the third touchdown catch for Corey Coleman.
I can't say it enough. Corey Coleman is one heck of a receiver and one of the best in college football. And once again, they get the running game going, they soften up this defense, and what they do, they take a shot with one of the fastest guys on the field in man coverage.
Chris Callahan for the extra point. It is good. And Baylor's lead is back to 7. It took just 43 seconds. Very few of those seconds. It's clocking Corey Coleman running down the field.
Well, once again, you see that 4.38 speed lined up against Seth Ellis, who that last drive, Seth Ellis had a great interception to set up the touchdown. You'll see him down here. Look at all this room that he has to work. He runs just a straight 9 route, a little hop, gets some separation. And you can tell all practice long and all camp, Seth has been working with him because he understands how fast he is and where he needs to lay that ball out. Such ease, such precision when he throws that football. It looks so easy, but that's a tough throw.
And perhaps a little confidence back for Seth Russell, who had thrown a couple of interceptions. The numbers may surprise you for Seth Russell in this game. He has only thrown 4 incomplete passes. 2 of them were intercepted. He's 18 of 22 for 286 yards and 3 touchdowns. Corey Coleman now has 5 grabs for 148. And you see the quick strikes for Baylor. 2 drives, less than a minute in this first half. Rodney Randall have a chance to run it back. He's got a hole. He breaks a tackle and he gets to the 34-yard line before he's brought down by Tyler James. Let's go to Jenny Taft in Los Angeles for a game break. Jenny?
Well, Brendan, a top 10 matchup in East Lansing between number 5 Michigan State and number 7 Oregon. Connor Cook finds senior Aaron Burbridge, who fights his way into the end zone for the 17-yard strike. Michigan State just stuffed Oregon on 4th and goal. Spartans up 14-7.
That's going to be a fantastic game as that game plays out. Connor Cook, one of the best quarterbacks in the country. He could do a lot, put himself in the Heisman contention with a big game today.
And it'll do a lot for trying to measure the Pac-12 against the Big Ten as well. Play clock down to three. Down to one. Never got it off. The penalty yardage racking up.
Number 10, 5-yard penalty, first down.
You know, with all the miscues and mistakes that Lamar's had, a couple times they've done this. A bunch of penalties, a bunch of kind of dumb penalties on pre-snap. We saw the unsportsmanlike, somewhat okay with some of those aggressive plays, but you're playing in Waco. You can't keep making mistakes and setting your offense back.
They get the snap off this time. Minden wants to keep it. This time, Baylor not fooled. The linebackers, Grant Campbell, Avion Edwards, swallowed him up after a yard. Lamar is actually trying to beat Baylor for the second consecutive meeting. Now, I mentioned that this is only the sixth year of the program for Lamar, but it's the sixth year of their resurrected program. Lamar beat Baylor 18-17 in 1981 at Floyd Casey Stadium to open the season. Mike Marlowe, a 42-yard field goal as time expired. The win for Lamar. Handoff was to Cade Harrington. Jamal Palmer on the tackle. It'll be third and 10. Approaching 3 minutes remaining here in the first half. Baylor and Lamar have gone back and forth in this football game. But Lamar has struggled on third down. They are 1-for-6 today. 3 receivers all at the bottom. They roll that way. And it's underthrown, looking for Jace Nelson. And a flag coming in late. Right back near that offensive line for Lamar. And it is going against that offensive line.
Personal foul. Chop block. Offense. Number 50. 78. 15-yard penalty. Third down.
Penalty was actually against number 58, Brett Treadway, the right guard.
We're going to see him right there on big number 75, Andrew Billings. Can't come across like that and block back below the waist. Anytime you see that, that's a clear call. That was an easy call to make. You understand what he was trying to do, but when you're blocking back like that, you got to block high.
After the penalty, third and 25. And this time it looked like Baylor may have jumped. Dan Romeo has been prominently featured in our first half.
And a lot of it, again, is going against Lamar.
False start. Offense. Number 8. 5-yard penalty. Third down.
Kent, third and 30.
And that time it's the running back. You can't have running backs. There's no urgency as a running back to get off, especially when you know it's going to be a third down. Big passing play, just hold your water. So Lamar putting themselves way back. Expect a screen or something here.
They just trying to dump it off, and it nearly got intercepted. Baylor was able to break through it with Sean Oakman applying the pressure on Joe Minden.
Well, you can see now why Cade Harrington jumped on that last play, because that play was going to him. He needed to set up. You just see Blackshear grapple and hold on. That's okay. He's behind the line of scrimmage. That's a fine play. Trying to set up that screen pass. You see a lot of that on third long, just trying to pick up some cheap yardage. And now another flag.
They lined up for the punt.
Intentional grounding. Offense. Number 10. Was in the pocket. Through the area where there's no receiver. Penalty enforced at the spot of foul. Lost it down. Fourth down.
I mean, I'm pretty sure Kate Harrington was in the vicinity.
Yeah, he was just being swallowed up by a much bigger guy.
And why did it take as long as to line up for the punt to throw that flag? Really, you had to think about it.
I'm not really sure what happened there, what the miscommunication was, but regardless, they're still going to punt.
Okay, so fourth and 40. From the back of the end zone, Juan Carranco will send it to Lynx Hawthorne, and he muffs it. Is able to get on top of it. But Baylor will start the drive from the Lamar 44-yard line.
And just a wasted opportunity, an easy punt to catch, not a lot of hang time. There wasn't a defender within about 10 or 15 yards, so a big missed opportunity right there for Lynx Hawthorne.
Let's take a look at our Academy Sports Red Stuff key player so far for Baylor. Corey Coleman, 5 catches, 3 of them for touchdowns.
Yeah, again, he's such a dynamic receiver. Back shoulder catches, great body awareness, doing a good job in the air, body control, good hands, and that speed we talked about, 4.38.
Johnny Jefferson gets forward to the 40. Just a couple of yards, Tommy Barrett. Junior making the tackle. Baylor has a stable of running backs. It was Shaq Linwood a lot early. Johnny Jefferson, impressive here, gets within a yard. It'll be third and one. Sean Jones on the tackle. We've seen Shaq Linwood. We've seen Devin Chafin. Johnny Jefferson last week only had a couple of carries, but he went for 28 yards in that win over SMU. Russell will hand it off again. Looking for just a yard, and I don't think he got there. They're going to mark him just shy. It'll bring up fourth and one. And Baylor's offense doesn't flinch.
I think on that play, they were just trying to get off the ball quick and catch him off guard, but I think the offensive linemen weren't even set, didn't get a chance to dig it out either.
Devin Chafin, the big heavy back. And there wasn't contact till a couple of yards after the first down.
Well, you talked about Johnny Jefferson coming in on that drive. We got an injured player right now, but that's how these guys can hurt you. You got Linwood, Terrence Williams will come in as a redshirt freshman, Devin Chafin, Johnny Jefferson, a whole stable of running backs that are extremely fast and some of them are very powerful.
Injured players, nose tacker Omar Tebow. They asked Art Briles about the luxury of having 3 strong, proven running backs and a mobile quarterback. He quickly corrected the question. Luxury? We may need another word for that. Because he feels it's necessary, if you want to win a championship, to have 2-3 options in the backfield, especially to make it through an entire year with the type of offense that they play and the type of defenses they play against.
Well, it's the type of offense that they run, and you said it exactly right. They are going to go quick. They're going to get a ton of plays off. They're going to get 80 to 90 snaps a game, and you can't just leave that load on 1 or 2 guys. You have to have 3 or 4 guys, and luckily for them, they have 4 guys that they can pick from. A couple older guys, a couple younger guys. They just hit you with speed, speed, speed all the time.
Omar Tebow being helped off the field. He's the nose tackle. He's right in the middle of your screen.
You'll see him right there, the big nose tackle, 330-pound nose tackle. Looks like his own player comes in as he's posted up and just kind of clips the knee.
Tebow's their only guy back on the defensive line. And a second team All-Southland Conference last year. Coach Ray Woodard said, he's 330 pounds, he's one of the strongest guys, but he's just vertically challenged. That's his problem, as the rush goes ahead to the 25-yard line for Devin Chafin.
Well, that's really the reason why he didn't get recruited to bigger programs, was just because of short stature. But they said his skill set, his strength, his explosiveness is right up there with a lot of Division I players.
Chafin with a gaping hole, and he gets dropped down inside the 10. 46 seconds left in the half. After the 18-yard run by Chaffin, Baylor has it at the 8. And the flags come flying in as Baylor tried to line up quickly and get that snap off. We have seen Baylor on a decent tempo, but it hasn't been that race car tempo from the normal Baylor offense tonight.
False start. Offense, number 58. This foul qualifies for the 10-second subtraction. I'm going to determine each team's options.
Very well stated.
All right. So he's going to determine the options. We're going to talk about the fact that Baylor's offense has slowed down a little bit, and that's not the first time we've seen them try and go into that tempo and wind up taking a false start penalty.
Yeah, they just seem out of sorts in a lot of areas.
False start. Offense, number 58. 5-yard penalty. First down. The defense has elected to accept the 10-second subtraction. Clock operator, please reset the game clock to 31 seconds. However, Baylor has chosen to use one of their team timeouts to conserve that time. First charge timeout, Baylor. 30-second timeout.
Hey, he ran through everything for us.
A very healthy explanation. I think everybody understands now Baylor had 3 timeouts. If they didn't elect to use one, they're going to have a 10-second runoff. They did use one, so now 2 timeouts left for Baylor and no 10-second runoff. So they have 41 seconds and 2 timeouts to punch one in here.
Hey, coming up on the Fox College Football Halftime Show, Rob Stone, Matt Leiner, Dave Wannstedt talking top 25 highlights. And they'll talk and look at Auburn, Notre Dame, Ohio State. A lot of big games going on today. And, of course, some Big 12 highlights and discussion. We've got TCU and Kansas State, Ben.
Kansas State goes down to UTSA and gets a 30-3 win, but wasn't pretty, but they got the win.
New quarterback, Joe Huebner, getting his first ever start. Ever?
Ever. Quarterback. In high school, anywhere. Not a bad stage down there at the Alamo Dome.
Chuck Linwood bounces off a tackler and scores. Baylor gets a little breathing room here late in the first half. A 13-yard run by Chuck Linwood.
We'll take a look at 55 right here. That's the Mike linebacker, Matt Johnson. Has a shot at him. He's clean. Right there. Lamar's done a really good job throughout this whole game of making sure tackles. That time playing off a block. He needs to make that tackle. He doesn't. And Linwood, at 5'9", 200 pounds, a smooth, silky runner for being a short-statured guy, punches it in the end zone.
Second touchdown run tonight for Chuck Linwood. And now we've got more flags being thrown after the extra point, and we could be seeing more 15-yard penalties and more unsportsmanlike conducts handed out. They had to pull the kicker and the punter out of the pile as the punter, Juan Carranco, is actually the holder.
Unsportsmanlike conduct, number 58, Baylor. Penalty being forced on the kickoff. That's number 58's first unsportsmanlike of the game.
Spencer Drango, their left tackle, top prospect.
That's 3 times now we've called Drango's name for not the right reasons.
And that's pretty obvious and pretty well sold.
And that's not Drango. That's Rami Hamad, the backup, the third string center who's out there in field goal protection, is the one that threw that right hook there. So I don't believe that was Drango who got the flag. I think that was Rami Hamad.
Yeah, so we'll give Drango the pass.
We'll give him the pass.
And we will also be handing out an Academy Award at halftime to William Wolquack, the defensive lineman.
You got to sell it sometimes. You got to sell it.
It's football. The other football. And we normally see that. 35 seconds to go in our first half. Baylor has their largest lead of the football game. It is 14 points. A squib kick will keep on bouncing. It is scooped up by Michael Handy. And he is bottled up at the 17-yard line. Just a 6-yard return for Handy.
Hey, we've got no flags on the play. That might be the first in about the last 10 minutes.
Baylor had a 7-0 lead. Lamar was able to come back and tie it, as you see the latest scoring drive by Baylor to give them the 14-point lead. But it was 13-7 Baylor, then 14-13 Lamar, 21-14 Baylor, 21-21, 28-21 Baylor, and now 35-21. It took them a while to get the separation. They finally have it. And here you go. They will take a knee out of the shotgun where they are more comfortable. It looks awkward, but it is just as effective.
Well, sometimes when you have that quarterback going under center, you don't want a bad center quarterback exchange, especially you just want to kneel the football. So right now, Lamar's got to figure out how to get some momentum back into their offense.
Let's go down to the field and Christian Steckel. Christian?
Coach, why is your team struggling so much defensively at the line of scrimmage against the zone read tonight?
They're doing a good job executing. You know, we turned the ball over 3 times second quarter, so we're fortunate enough to be up by 14. You know, we got to come out, take care of the ball, try to score the opening drive second half and separate a little bit. But Lamar's playing extremely well, and we got to play better.
For a guy who values the football and Seth Russell, how do you explain his 3 first-half turnovers?
Can't. You know, that's we're growing, and we'll grow together.
All right, Coach, thanks so much. Brendan, back to you.
That's a pretty calm Art Briles. I don't think he'll be too calm when he gets into the locker room. Our score here at halftime, Baylor 35, Lamar 21. Coming up next, we'll head to L.A. for the Fox College Football Halftime Show. Rob Stone, Matt Leinart, Dave Wamstedt showing some highlights for the top 25, talking Auburn, Notre Dame, Ohio State, and of course your Big 12 highlights, TCU, Kansas State, both putting up wins this afternoon. 5-21 lead over Lamar University.
Well, Lamar's going to start off with Harrington, Cade Harrington, coming out with the touchdown to answer Baylor's. And then from there, it was 14 points off of turnovers. A fumble by Seth Russell set up this touchdown. And then an interception sets up another touchdown. So Lamar with 14 points off the turnovers. And Baylor, their offense has been all about Corey Coleman, speedy, NFL ready, one of the best receivers in the league. A couple routes, just get manned up on the outside. And beautiful passes and touch by Seth Russell, as we can see here. But that's really been the story of this game. It's the points off of turnovers for Lamar. And this Baylor offense just highlighting what Corey Coleman can do on the outside. Lamar's got to find an answer here in the second half to see if they can match up with the speed and slow down Corey Coleman. And for more of that, let's go down to CT on the sidelines with Lamar's head coach, Ray Woodard.
Well, guys, I actually had a chance to talk with Coach Woodard coming out of the locker room, and he told me simply, look, you got to talk to me now because we put ourselves in a position where we could win this football game. And I said, Coach, why are you guys having so much success at the line of scrimmage against the zone read? He said, look, we're running the ball effectively because we're the tougher team right now. Our guys really want to win this football game, and the belief is coming. I said, if you get into the second half now and you get Carson Earp running the ball downhill and you guys are making plays, would you potentially decide to stick with him and run him the final 30 minutes of this game? He said, we're going to ride the hot hand. And have I told you? I think we have a chance to win this game. Guys?
Well, at the beginning of the game, I'm not sure anyone would have believed him. At halftime?
Yeah.
I'll buy it. Time now for our first half summary presented by Quicken Loans. And there you see the numbers a lot closer. 395 total yards for Baylor, 164 for Lamar. And there you see Ben making his point. 3 turnovers.
Well, I think that's been the story here, is Lamar's defense getting sacks, strip fumble, a couple interceptions off some miscues with Seth Russell and his receivers, but they've turned that into 14 points. They've rode out some of these emotional shifts back and forth, and they're hanging, beating up this offensive defensive line for Baylor and really showing these guys that, hey, we can play, and they're going to believe, and they're going to play really, really hard this second half to try to win this football game.
Listen, man, nobody was going to say it pregame. We talked to Art Briles yesterday. He wasn't going to say it. But the plan for today was to have Seth Russell sitting down with his helmet off at the start of the second half. That's what the plan was playing against Lamar. Jared Stidham is supposed to be starting this half. I don't think we're going to see him, at least not yet. I think you've got to see your starters still out there at the start of the third quarter which is something I don't think they wanted to do.
No, I don't think that was the plan. I mean, the plan for Baylor was to play their starters for the first half, you know, blow the doors off these guys and get your backups and reserves to get some game experience. And for Lamar, you know, they want to come out and control the football, you know, run the football on offense. Defensively, just don't have any big plays over the top. They've been a little successful, but for the most part, I don't think anybody expected here in the first half that Lamar to have 21 points and be hanging with these big boys in Waco.
Lamar's played an FBS opponent five times in the past 6 years. They've lost by at least 40 in four of those five games. And this one right through the wickets of Ishmael Zamora. And a touchback for a lucky Baylor Bear in the end zone. Seth Russell, during that first half, aside from the turnovers, some pretty good numbers.
Aside from the turnovers. You know, last week he was extremely inefficient. Even surprised Art Briles after the game. He's like, I didn't realize he was 50% because he was so productive. This game, efficiency is up, but taking care of the football is down. And I think if you ask any coach in the league, they'd rather have you take care of the football and be and live with the inefficiency. So Baylor has to figure out the miscues on offense and get Seth to not turn the ball over.
He hands it off on first down to Shock Linwood as he gets loose with a spin move. First down and more from Linwood. He jumps back and he's pushed out of bounds just shy of midfield. Nice run by Shock Linwood. He got 22.
Well, it's the footwork and the vision. You'll see him in the open field. And then KD Cannon with the key block going down the field. You can see him right there continuing going down. Receivers have to do that if you're not going to get the football.
Complete pass right at the sticks to KD Cannon. Give him nine. Lloyd Julian made the catch. And a nice break on that football by Cannon as it was let go by Russell. So second and one. As Baylor has a chance to go up by 21 if they can punch one in here. Again, they give it to Linwood, and he gets 10 yards and a first down.
Going with more of a power football approach, they bring in Gus Penny, number 15, the tight end. Line him up as an H-back as the lead blocker, and he cleared the way right there on a big run.
Russell has plenty of time. Pumps twice, and then resets himself. Looking towards the end zone, there's Cannon! Coleman! Touchdown! The fourth receiving touchdown for Corey Coleman. Baylor works quickly on their first possession of the second half.
That's the hardest coverage for a defensive player, scramble coverage. First of all, give a lot of credit to the offensive line of Baylor, holding there for 7, 8, 9 seconds, allowing Seth Russell to find the open Corey Coleman. But as a defense, when you see the play break down, and these receivers just, it's like spaghetti on a plate. They just run all around the field. It's backyard football. And what does Corey Coleman do? He trusts his speed. I'm going to turn this thing up. And that's the second time now that Seth Ellis, the cornerback, has been burned by Corey Coleman.
So Baylor gets the ball to start the second half. They march right down the field. And they put up 7 points. And all of a sudden, they've doubled up Lamar, 42-21. Art Briles said before going to the break at halftime that they needed to come out and score and then start the third quarter, and that's exactly what they've done.
Well, you'll see here down at the bottom of the screen, once again, it's Corey Coleman. We've talked about him all game. Look at the line protection. A quick little play action pass, but there's no pressure on Seth Russell. And then all of a sudden, things break down. Scramble coverage. There looked to be a slip on the outside that caused the separation with Ellis. And that's actually Seth Ellis's third blown coverage. And Corey Coleman had 3 touchdowns on Seth Ellis. And that's never good. Never good for your confidence, especially when you're going against one of the best receivers in the game.
See Corey Coleman now over 2,000 receiving yards in his career. That's on 110 catches. And tonight, it's on 6 catches, 182 yards, and 4 of those 6 catches have been for touchdowns. And that is a new Baylor record with 4 receiving touchdowns in the same game. We've played 56 seconds in the second half.
We talked about it in the open, like how good these receivers are. And we haven't even really gotten Jay Lee. He was involved early in the first and second series, but he's a dangerous receiver. And KD Cannon, we've talked about a little bit as well. But you don't need those two other guys when you've got Corey Coleman.
They're legends, icons, and warriors. Starting next month, two of the biggest names in the UFC will face off as coaches. As interim featherweight champion Conor McGregor and Uriah Faber join an all-new season of The Ultimate Fighter, the mayhem continues Wednesday only on Fox Sports 1. So the question was, at the break, which quarterback would we see for the third quarter for Lamar? Carson Earp started the game. He looked strong, 6 of 10, 42 yards. Joe Minden came in, played the second quarter. He went 3 for 5 for 35 through the air. Earp is the more mobile, and it is Carson Earp to start the third quarter.
And I think that's the smart play. He started the first quarter. I know that we're going to see Joe Minden come in the second quarter, but I think Carson provided this offense with a little more versatility and flexibility with his ability to run the football.
Out of the backfield, Cade Arrington got popped by Chance Waz.
Man, you could hear that all the way up here. Chance Waz coming down from the safety position. Take it. Listen to this. Everybody with a collective reaction, they heard that and felt that hit by Chance Waz.
Well, Cade Arrington still lined up there next there to the left of Carson Earp. And they give it right back to him, but he ran right into his own man and then is gang tackled by Baylor. The whole defensive line, Oakman, Billings, Blackshear, they're all in there.
I wouldn't be surprised, maybe not on this drive because it's third down, to come right back to that and attack Sean Oakman. Oakman crashed down, and I think Carson, as he pulled the football, realized, man, I should have kept that thing because it would have been wide open for a big game.
Third and 7 for Lamar. Empty backfield for Carson Earp. Baylor showing blitz. Had to get rid of it in a hurry. The pass is complete, but nowhere to go. Chance Waz, Trayvon Blanchard. And a 2-yard loss on the complete pass to Reggie Bagleton.
And that's how it goes for this Baylor defense. They've given up 21 points in the first half. It's either feast or famine with these guys. 3 scoring drives in the first half, 18 plays, 142 yards. The other 7 drives, 6 three and outs. So here we go with the 7th three and out. It's the lack of consistency that you see. You love the three and outs, but you can't have those long extended drives if you want to be a dominant defense.
Another decent punt for Juan Caranco. 38 yards back to the Baylor side of the field. Back to Corey Coleman. Seth Russell, the Bears, up by 21. Ground points come in the air. Can you dig it? At Baylor, they can throw it. Defenses seem to be MIA as the Bears go to the AIR. Broken scoreboards and busted records. You want scoring? Start counting. More than 50 on the board 12 times in the last 2 years. They spread the field, they push the pace, protect the pocket, and chuck the rock. Baylor, downright offensive. Baylor closing in on 50 again. Opening stages, third quarter, they've got 42. They're up by 21. Seth Russell with time. And this one is complete. Ishmael Zamora trying to get away. And he could not. Lawrence Hale finished him. Seth Ellis held on to him. 6-yard pickup for Ishmael Zamora. That's his first catch of the football game. Russell's 21 of 26 for now 331 yards. And he's got another complete pass right at the first down marker for Lynx Hawthorne. And it is a first down after a 5-yard gain. Tommy Barrett, Boyd Julian on the deck.
Well, this is the efficiency that they're looking for. Again, last week only 50% efficiency throwing the football for Seth Russell. Outside of the 3 takeaways and turnovers that he's had, he's been awfully efficient with that short, quick passing game and the deep balls of Corey Coleman.
Russell steps up, looking, and it's picked off again. Rodney Randall running it back. Randall to the 40 in Baylor territory. Got a block. He's down to the 25. the third interception by Seth Russell today, and some flags came in at the end of the run. Manasseh Miles is also down on the sideline being tended to by the training staff. It is a 53-yard return by Rodney Randall, the true freshman. Another Baylor turnover. Three picks and a fumble from that man, Seth Russell.
Well, I was giving Seth Russell the benefit of the doubt on some of the turnovers. He got to hold on the football. When you get sacked, he lost that one. I put that one on him. But it looked like the two other interceptions were just miscommunication with the receivers. Sometimes that happens. This particular play, Rodney Randall just runs the route, and it was a bad and a poor decision for Seth to throw that football on the run as he's rolling to his right. It was a great play by Randall. A nice return, but as we wait, Manasseh Miles goes down on the return. We get flags
personal
on the play.
Foul, legal block below the waist. Offense, number 17. That penalty will be added to the end of the run. First down.
And it could be Seth Russell when he went to go make the tackle. Went low, takes out Manasseh Miles. So once again, like I was talking, good coverage. He rolls out to his right. This is just a poor decision. You have to be able to see in that situation the tight coverage. Rodney Randall runs the route, and Seth just couldn't get any juice on that football when he was throwing and rolling to his right. And you'll see him come from the right of your screen, going down for the tackle. But he ends up just taking out Manasseh Miles. And that's what the penalty was for, is chopping him down. Manasseh Miles goes down as they tend to him now on the sidelines to check that knee.
So after the penalty, Lamar will get the ball on the 15-yard line. Maybe. Officials will get together and make sure the penalty is enforced properly. Manasseh Miles, the one receiving the treatment on that right leg. Is there starting left end? So they've moved the ball up a couple of yards. So instead of the 15, it's the 13. The second drive Lamar's had in this game that starts in the red zone. Earp trying to get to the edge, and he was met there by Xavier Howard and Orion Stewart.
Just a real headsy play by Stewart to come down and fill right there. They know that the zone read's coming. That's the first time they've gone with that two tight end set. And Earp decides to keep that one. So Ryan Stewart's there to run the alley and make the nice play. Tackle for loss there for Orion Stewart.
Lamar perfect in the red zone. They were 6-for-7 last week in their route over Bacon. Earp to pass. Just out of the reach of Reggie Bagleton. They went looking for their biggest playmaker, and they nearly found him.
Well, and it's the same route that they ran earlier in the game, and Bagleton came up with the pass to set him up for a touchdown. This time just a little bit outside. You'll see him just bend it down to the corner. Got the separation. You can see the speed that Bagleton has. Again, the coaches really think that he's an NFL type of receiver they have on their football team.
On third and 12. Earp. Got the second receiver, Devin Brown. I'm not sure that's where he was trying to get it. Bagleton may have been the intended target, but it got through to Devin Brown.
Well, they went right back to the well. They had success with it last play. Bagleton on this exact same route. This time, they had Brown running behind him just off the fingertips, and if Brown was paying a little bit more attention, he could have made the tough catch for a touchdown.
Up to settle for a field goal try. It'll be a 31-yard attempt for Alex Ball. And he puts it through. He's a perfect 9-for-9 in his career on field goals. So Lamar off the interception and the long return has to settle for just 3 points, even though they started their drive on the 13-yard line. Seth Russell's third pick of the game. This one from Rodney Randall, who ran it all the way back. But they come up just short, have to settle for a field goal. Number 4, Baylor. Let's go to Los Angeles and Jenny Tapp for a game break.
Well, Brendan, Kent State beat Delaware State today, 45-13, but that's not why we're showing you this. Number 91, April Goss, the fifth-year senior, kicks an extra point, becoming only the second woman to ever score a point in an FBS college football game. A little bit of history for Kent State. Awesome to see as her teammates carry her off the field.
What a moment that's got to be for her, getting carried off on the shoulders. Who doesn't love a moment like that?
I wouldn't know.
You come
might
on.
Know. No one has ever carried me off of anything.
Maybe we can get McGowan to do that for you tonight.
Get him up to the booth here. Earp has a man out there, but he overshot him. Pressure came from Brian Nance. Earp picks himself back up, trying to go to Reggie Bagleton out there.
That's one of the few times on a passing play that Baylor's been able to get to the quarterback and disrupt the throw. You're going to see Nance come over here right there. A nice little inside move. So the backup defensive end in for Sean Oakman, making his presence felt.
Carson Earp started the game 8-for-11. Now he's thrown 5 consecutive incomplete passes. They hand it to Carl Harris, typically a wide receiver. He lined up in the backfield and gets 5. Down to the field with CT Steckel. Christian?
Guys, Katie Cannon came over to the bench. They worked on the inside of his left knee and determined there really was nothing wrong. Asked him to get up and walk it off. He came over to the bench, slammed his helmet. Seth Russell came over and sat down right next to him. Quarterbacks and receivers trying to get on the same page, fellas.
Well, it's great news that Cannon is not severely injured. I mean, it's always weird when you see that leg and that knee kind of wobble like that. Glad to see him back. And Seth Ellis, the cornerback on that play, he was shaken as well. So hopefully he's back in the game on the next possession.
This is Carl Harris again getting a first down as he gets out to the 40, a 10-yard carry. Brian Nance makes the tackle as they've gotten to Carl Harris, not one of their 4 running backs that they used in last week's game, but Harris was a running back last season when Cade Harrington and Emmett Raleigh both went down with injuries. Played well, and they go back to him here. He is a senior, a transfer from Memphis, where he was a running back there as well. Played in 7 games in 2012. With Memphis as a redshirt freshman. Again, it is Harris. And Harris tripped up by the diving arm of Chance Waz. Otherwise, he was gone, limited to just 13 yards.
You'll see the linebackers abandon their gap responsibilities. There's no second level of this defense. They've got this whole defensive front 7 confused by the zone read. They're going to have to figure something out because it's been giving them fits the last 2 weeks. You're going to see it all throughout the Big 12 as they get into their round-robin play. Middle linebackers, edge guys, all have to be on the same page. They're getting gashed right now.
4 wide receivers and the running back, Harris, and Harris slips. Right back at the line of scrimmage, his legs just went out from under him. And so after no gain, they'll line it up again. Last week, after giving up 21 points in the first half to SMU, Baylor's defense able to shut it down and shut them out in the second half. They had a very short field that led to a field goal as Bagleton lays out and he grabbed it. Scoops it off the turf, and it's a first down, down to the 35-yard line.
How many times are we going to see Bagleton have to reach out and dive for a football? One of these times are going to have an opportunity to maybe throw it to him as he's running in stride to see what he can do with the football in his hands.
Handoff goes to Cade Harrington. Andrew Billings on the stop, a two-yard gain. That catch by Bagleton, the 180th of his career. That is 10th all-time in the Southland Conference.
Second down.
Well, I like, again, the methodical approach going back what they did in the first quarter with Carson Earp calling the plays and running the zone read. Short, quick passing. Again, wear out this Baylor defense. They get just as antsy as much as the offense does. They want to get off the field as well.
Play clock down to three. Arrington. Put it on the ground. Baylor looks like they have it. They have not made a signal. Now they do. Baylor football. That is the first turnover forced tonight by Baylor.
Well, and there it is. That's going to be the 18th straight game that Baylor has at least one takeaway. It's taken them all the way into the late in the third quarter. But I think he just hits it on his own guy. Cody Ahlens, the left tackle. Cade just tried to make a little spin move, tried to sidestep. And the football and the elbow just hit the hip of Cody Ahlens. So right now, Baylor finally with their first takeaway late here in the third quarter.
Avion Edwards, the linebacker starting for the injured Taylor Young, got the recovery. And there's a nice job right up the middle. Shock Linwood. Xavier Bethany's helmet came off on the play, so he needs to leave the field for one. True freshman Davin Jernigan takes his place as they go back to Linwood. What a spin move. Stumbling and rumbling down close to the 35. Seth Ellis finally knocked it down after 19 yards. Boy, is he hard to stop.
It's about time this offensive line would mash this defensive line. I would say up to this point, they haven't been exuding their dominance. They're much bigger, more physical guys. We're starting to see that now here late in the third quarter.
Carry this time is Johnny Jefferson. And Jefferson stays up. And he's down to the 22-yard line. 15 yards for Jefferson, it's the redshirt sophomore.
Great balance set up by Blake Muir. The left guard came across on the pulling guard and set up that running play, but look at that balance, that control.
And look at him put the shoulder down as well. Jefferson gets 9. He ran right over Davin Jernigan. Tommy Bear was able to make that stop. Jefferson 5'10", 210. Shoemaker, Texas. And he got hit down to the 7-yard line. He gets 6.
And again, it's this offensive line. They brought in a whole rotation of new defensive line guys, trying to keep them fresh, but they weren't quite ready. And this offensive line pushed everybody to about 5 or 6 yards before there's even first contact.
After riding Jefferson, they bring Linwood back in. And he changes directions. A stiff arm, and he gets away.
Boy, we saw it all on that one drive. Shock Linwood with the speed, the power, a silky type of runner with great balance. Johnny Jefferson comes into the game. Great energy, hand on the ground, keeping on his feet. And then you cap it off with Linwood once again showing that prowess he has as a running back. He can pretty much do everything. That's why he's the starter. He can catch out of the backfield. He can run with power. He can run with speed. You saw there, ran with great balance.
Third rushing touchdown today for Shock Linwood, who had 16 of them a year ago. Extra point is good. And Baylor now with a 49-24 lead. That touchdown run, our Delta Faucet touch of the game. Let's take another look.
Well, like I said, he can pretty much do everything for this Baylor offense. At 5'9", 200 pounds, he's compact. He runs with power, a good center of gravity. And you can see just using that offhand to shoo away defenders and clear his feet. just a great job of just being a running back, just showing off that skill and that balance and that vision. It's a great drive by Baylor. How about that? Baylor doesn't attempt one pass in that drive, just let the running backs do it all.
And why not when you got Shaq Linwood and Johnny Jefferson? We'll see what Linwood's junior year has in store. He set a freshman rushing record, broke RG3's rushing record, 881 yards as a freshman, and then went and set the sophomore rushing record of the school last year, almost 1,300 yards. And now, as a junior, tonight, he's racked up 130 and three touchdowns. He had 75 yards in a week one win against SMU on the road. So Baylor, 1 point shy of 50. As this is Rodney Randall, who won't have the opportunity to run it back like he did on his interception return that went for 50-plus yards. Let's take a look at our Academy Sports Right Stuff key players so far for Lamar, and it's the running back, Cade Harrington. They've been riding him today.
Yeah, they've been riding him. They've been doing a good job of knowing when to pull the football, when to give it on this read option, this zone read that we keep talking about with Carson Earp. Kay's done a good job of running hard. 2 years ago, he was the conference freshman of the year. You can see why they rely on him so much, because he can be a dominant player, especially down in the red zone and up against the goal line.
But instead of Harrington on this play, it is Carl Harris again in the backfield. Carson Earp still the quarterback. Harris jams on the brakes. Cannot get away from Bo Blackshear. Local guy from Midway High School here in Waco. And at 6'4", 300 pounds, he just reached out and hauled him down.
And it was 48, Trayvon Blanchard, the nickel backer that came in off the edge, setting the edge, making the running back cut back, and good pursuit by Blackshear for the tackle for loss.
Blackshear didn't have one last week. He had 9.5 tackles for loss a year ago. All Big 12 honorable mention on that scary good defensive line for Baylor with Oakman, Billings, Blackshear, and Palmer. Earp has a little room, but he's dragged down. Ball came loose there at the end, but Trayvon Blanchard met him and dropped him after just a 4-yard gain.
Well, twice now we get to call Blanchard's name and number, set the edge on that first play. They did a good job of coming downhill, running the alley, and making the sure hard tackle, putting now Lamar in 3rd and 8, a little bit more predictable for defense.
At one point, this game was 21-21. Wasn't that long ago. Just over 4 minutes remaining in the second quarter. That was our score. Lamar looking on 3rd and 8, and they left Bagleton open. First down at the 40-yard line. At 13 yards, Orion Stewart, Trayvon Blanchard just gave a little too much space.
Well, it's the same go-to play they keep running down in the red zone. It's just a quick little waggle here to the right. Bagleton, lined up as a number two receiver, just sits down in that soft little zone and finds the sticks. If I'm Baylor, when I get in those situations now, got to cover up Bagleton, even if you just man-to-man, go man up on third down, take him out of the equation.
Emmett Raleigh, he's just getting hauled down. Andrew Billings, the first one there, and then the help game. Another 2-yard loss on the play for Lamar.
You know, Billings has been flashing here of late, had a tackle for loss in the second quarter. Now he shoots the gap again. Made his presence felt last week against SMU, but we were talking to the coaches about him. They said he needs to drop a little bit of weight to regain some of that quickness.
That was the final play of the third quarter. Baylor has distanced themselves, outscoring Lamar 14-3. In the third quarter of play, their lead is 49-24. Russell has had his struggles. He's thrown interceptions, 3 of them. But he's also thrown 4 touchdowns, and Shaq Linwood putting up points as well. quarter here at McLean Stadium in Waco, Texas. Number 4 Baylor up 49-24 over the FCS Lamar Cardinals. Brennan Burke, Ben Lieber, Christian Steckel with you here. Carson Earp will start the fourth quarter as the quarterback for Lamar. We'll see if he continues after this series. As you pick it up in the middle of one, it's second and 12. From their own 38. And Andrew Billings just swallowed Emmett Raleigh.
Wow. This whole second half, this Baylor defensive line has finally been getting the penetration. You see just crossing the face. Such a big, explosive man. Then playing with good leverage and just hammering Emmett Raleigh. So it's about time this Baylor defense has shown up. It's just taken a whole second half to get it going.
Lamar struggled on third downs tonight, 3 for 11, but they have converted their last two third down attempts. Earp on the move, has to get rid of it. A wobbly pass. It was behind Bagleton. He couldn't adjust. He had a lot of room out there. Trayvon Blanchard got lost. And the pass just couldn't connect with Reggie Bagleton. Sean Oakman forced the quick throw.
That's such a tough play as a quarterback when you're scrambling out to your left, your right-handed quarterback, and then you get a throw for distance. And then you got big Sean Oakman bearing down on you. So that's a tough play. It's a nice attempt. He's just lucky he didn't get that one picked off.
Caronco, the boot. Lynx Hawthorne calls for the fair catch in traffic. And he's able to take it at the 26-yard line. Let's check in with Christian Steckel. Christian?
Well, guys, the tradition here dating back to 1970 for the freshmen is pretty fun. The Baylor line. Everybody 3,000 strong, ready to storm the field. And guess what? The CT cam was in full effect today. Out of blast, guys. I jumped in there. I haven't done this thing in 15 years. You know, sometimes we hide it. We got to wear the blinders, if you will, as the journalist. But we ran. We had a great time. I didn't know at times if I should stop and help some of the girls up who had already fallen, or if I should just keep charging. So I had to get taken out myself. But we certainly had a good time talking to those kids. One of the things that they told me out there was simple. This is one of the reasons why they come to Baylor, to storm the field like that. Guys.
That's awesome.
I expected some more speed from you.
Give me a break. Come on. I was running way past people. I'm pretty fast. 5'3", 5'4", easy, Ben. Easy.
Oh, very cool. I love that tradition. And again, that's the freshman class. That's the incoming class of 2019 that gets to go out there and welcome their team onto the field. As Johnny Jefferson says he wasn't down, there were no whistles, and now they come in. Jefferson looked like he landed on a defender. At least he was trying to sell that. I mark him down after a 12-yard gain.
Well, there was no whistle because the umpire that usually makes that call got knocked over and didn't see it.
Yeah, and the arm's down.
Yeah, and he's down.
Russell, this time looking for Cannon, and it's too far.
And I don't know if it was just me or not. We saw Cannon on the last possession a little gimpy, took a knee or a thigh, comes back in the game. But on that particular pass, it looks like he pulled up a little bit and was kind of limping off the field. So I don't think KD Cannon with all that speed is 100%.
This is Terrence Williams, his first carry of the game. And he gets all the way down to the Cardinals 35, 23 yards on the carry. Ty Alexander on the stop.
Oh, we talk about Linwood and Chafin and Jefferson. You know, why not have a fourth redshirt freshman that can come in at 215 pounds and have a fresh running back against a worn down defense?
They give it to him again. And he's got himself another Baylor first down. It's now five different rushers that have combined for Baylor. They get him over 250 yards on the ground, bringing Johnny Jefferson. And they look for the big man, Laquan McGowan, and right through his hands.
Oh, Seth, more touch, man. You're throwing to a 400-pounder.
6'7", 4'10", tight end.
You'll see him come across right to left. He can't throw it that hard, man. A little more of touch. We want to see the big man roll.
He got a lot of attention for his 18-yard touchdown catch last year in the Cotton Bowl. So his first career catch. Still looking for number two. I mean, he's a big man.
I don't think there's anything sweeter than watching a big man score a touchdown.
4'10", size 22 shoe in high school. They actually had to contact the Phoenix Suns to get a pair of Shaq shoes for his basketball team. Thrown up in the air, Corey Coleman couldn't come down with it. Seth Ellis was in coverage. They were looking for Coleman's fifth touchdown grab. Take a look at how big Laquan McGowan is standing next to our guy, Christian Steckel, down on the field. Now, CT, he's 6'5".
Those arms are bigger than CT's thighs. If you can imagine, Laquan was a high school place kicker as well.
He did everything. I mean, not to mention his size, but he runs a 5'4", 240. He can bench 500 pounds, and when he benched at 225, 37 reps. This is a 36-yard field goal. The first field goal attempt of the season for Baylor and Chris Callahan. And it is good to tack on three more and push Baylor over the 50-point mark. 52-24 here in the fourth. College football on Fox Sports is presented by Academy Sports and Outdoors. Right stuff, low price, every day. And by Ford. Be unstoppable during SUV season with incredible savings. Only at your Texas Ford dealer. Ford is the best in Texas. Confident Baylor fans streaming back over the Umphrey Bridge to get back to the mainland. Here on the Brazos River. Their team up big, 59-24, the number four Baylor Bears up on the Lamar Cardinals. Johnny Jefferson now with 121 yards. It's a career high in that 46-yard touchdown run, also a career high for Jefferson, as Baylor now with two rushers over 100 yards. Rodney Randall will take it out from a step in, and he's knocked down to the 15-yard line. To Los Angeles we go, and Jenny Taft. Jenny?
Brendan, a huge top 10 matchup. Number 5 Michigan State hosting number 7 Oregon. After the Ducks scored to cut it to 3, the Spartans immediately answer back. LJ Scott, 38-yard touchdown run. East Lansing is alive, and they are loving it. Michigan State up 31-21 in the fourth quarter.
Ooh, that's going to set up. I know it's way down the road, like November 8th. But that's the game I think everybody around the country want to see of Ohio State, Michigan State. Michigan State comes out and wins. They've got a long season to play yet. But, man, that is going to be a huge game come November 8th.
On first down, they hand it off to Emmett Raleigh. And he gets forward for 3. What it also does, Ben, if Michigan State holds on, and they play close with Ohio State, but can't win, if they hang with the top team in the nation, and that's their only loss, that's a pretty strong resume, too.
It's a strong resume, but it goes back to what is the strength of schedule. You look at both teams, they don't really play anybody throughout the whole season. That's why that game so late in the season is circled, because that's the only true test for either one of them outside of this particular football game with Oregon. So, yeah, I think the ACC is down. Let's see how they play out, but I doubt it's possible to get two of the Big Ten in the top four, but we've seen crazier things in college football.
That was Tayon Sells in the backfield. Dropping him for a loss. It brings up 3rd and 8. And Emmett Raleigh's in there to the left of Joe Minden. Has to throw. Dunks it over the middle to Reggie Bagleton, and a first down as he's knocked out of bounds. Tayon Sells made the play on defense, but a 15-yard pickup for the top receiver for Lamar, who's closing in on 100 yards. That was his 9th catch. And now 88 yards on the evening.
You know, I just love these stories when we talk about Reggie Bagleton being NFL ready and all that stuff. He's kind of been the go-to guy, not only tonight, but throughout the course of their seasons and his time there. But he's a former walk-on.
He's one of these guys that nobody really gave a chance, comes and walks on, earns a scholarship, now has a degree in engineering coming up. So, you know, I love hearing the stories about these student athletes that believe in themselves and go out and prove it and become one of the best on the field.
Second and two, Minden. Another quick throw to Pagleton, and he steps out of bounds just shy of midfield. 8 yards for Pagleton. And again, you look at the quarterback situation for Lamar. Carson Earp, 10 of 19. He started a lot stronger than he finished that first quarter, and that's a tough situation, Ben, as a quarterback. You play an entire quarter, you sit an entire quarter, you go through halftime, then you come back out in the locker room for the third quarter and just expect to pick up where you left off when the game has changed dramatically as well.
Right. You know, so much about every position is about rhythm, and so much about being a quarterback is feeling the game, getting the rhythm, understanding what you have as the timing of your route to the receivers. You see a big run there by Carl Harris, but you're right. Coming in, coming out, I'm going to guess they have this big matchup with Sam Houston State next week. Number one team in FCS. Then they have a 10-day break until they play Southeastern Louisiana. I'm going to guess at least in that break they're going to name the starter.
You would think that they would like to name it and just settle on it just for the team's sake. Just make a call. That was a 31-yard run by Carl Harris that sets Lamar up at the Baylor 20. Over the top and a touchdown, Brendan Langley from 20 yards out. And it's Lamar's first touchdown of the second half.
Well, we talk about this quarterback battle between Joe Minden and Carson Earp. Two differing styles. Earp is the runner, Minden is the passer. You saw it right there on that beautiful touchdown pass to Brendan Langley, the transfer from Georgia. Good location over the left shoulder, away from the defender, with a lot of touch, a very catchable football. This decision that Ray Woodard, the head coach, and Chuck Langston, the offensive coordinator, it's going to be a tough one to decide who's going to run this offense going forward this season.
Extra point is good, and the lead is 59-31 for Baylor. Joe Minden up top, the transfer from Georgia, Brendan Langley, and Lamar showing a little late life with a touchdown here in the fourth quarter. The Baylor Bears in 2008. Baylor 7-0 against FCS opponents, averaging 55 points in those wins. Above average tonight, 59
this,
right now.
This offense, when it gets going, is just incredible. They can do it through the air, the big plays. They can grind it out. You know, most of this second half has been all running game. They can beat you with three receivers, four different running backs. Awfully tough to stop.
Chris Platt gets out to the 22-yard line. Time now for our turning point of the game, presented by Ally Bank. And there were plenty of touchdowns to choose from for Corey Coleman. How about the fourth one? This one really said, I think we're done here for the Baylor offense, as Seth Russell had all the time in the world and then some, and then just lofted it out and said, hey, Corey, go get it.
Well, not only did offensive line do a great job on that particular play, but Corey Coleman's had an outstanding game with four touchdowns. But that really was the point where the Baylor defense finally stepped up and played to their capabilities against this FCS team. They had a three and out, they forced another punt. They had another sudden change where they held for just a field goal, so they finally played dominant defense that we've been waiting to see. They need to take that next step. They want to be a championship team. This defense has to step up. They have to play dominant defense like they have in the second half. They'll get another opportunity after this bye week. They've got Rice coming in. Rice is a little bit more balanced. They can play with them athletically, so that's another big test for them here in 2 weeks.
Nice stiff arm by Terrence Williams, who brings it across the 35 before he's shoved out of bounds by Rodney Randall. 17-yard gain, and well, Baylor now has over 700 yards of offense. It's the 10th time since 2012 they've hit the 700-yard mark. Jarrett Stidham's first pass is complete to Davion Hall. And he's out to the 50, another Baylor first down. That is the 20th play tonight for Baylor's offense that has gone for 10-plus. And 723 yards last week, and Stidham is sacked for the second time on this possession. Dedrick Garner brought him down for a 10-yard loss.
Well, when you bring in the backup quarterback, sometimes and a lot of times you bring in the backup offensive lineman. Patrick Lawrence, number 77, gives up the inside move. Too many times now already that we've seen Stidham on the ground.
Complete pass, Chris Platt. Trying to get back to midfield. Let's go back to last week. Jared Stidham came in late in the fourth quarter. First passing attempt of his collegiate career for the true freshman. Makes it look easy. Chris Platt, yeah, he just hooked up with 42-yard touchdown pass.
Not a bad way to start your college career.
Prep All-American, graduated early from Stephenville High School, enrolled in Baylor in January of last year. Three-time All-State quarterback and receiver in high school at Stephenville. An Under Armour All-American. I mean, this guy was a huge get, and we talked about all the praise that Art Briles had for him. Says he's ready to go right now. So is Seth Russell. Stidham complete. First down for Baylor.
You know, the one thing I notice about him, he's 18 years old. He's got good size already at 6'3", 210, but you watch the way the ball comes out of his hand. He just kind of flicks it, and he's got some velocity and some zip behind it, and that last pass play showed that with some accuracy.
Terrence Williams on the run. Flag comes in. An 11-yard carry for Williams. By the way, that last pass complete was to Chris Johnson, who's actually the third-string quarterback if they would ever need one.
Offense, number 68, 10-yard penalty, first down.
It's Ishmael Wilson, the backup left tackle. And we do have an injured player on the field, Corbin Carr. The left end for Lamar. Started to try and make it off the field, and they said, hang on, just go down, we'll come and get you. Junior, 6'3", 245 from Nederland High School. Which is about 20 minutes southwest of Beaumont, which is where Lamar University is located. In case you weren't familiar.
Would you Google that?
At one point.
That's unbelievable.
Not just now. You never know what you're going to need, Ben. 4 minutes to go here in the fourth quarter. Baylor is up 59-31. And another handoff to Terrence Williams. Just a tall, punishing running back. And another option in the deep stable for Art Briles. And his son, Kendall Briles, who is the offensive coordinator in his first season at that position. But he is not at that position tonight. Suspended for one game, recruiting violations. They're looking for Platt again. This one is overthrown. I'm talking about the deep stable of running backs they have. How about Platt? Another guy who's also on the Baylor track team coming in at receiver for Baylor.
Yeah, we talked about Corey Coleman, 4.38. KD Cannon, one of the fastest guys. He's on the 4x1 team along with Chris Platt. So when we say they're track guys and they're fast, we actually mean it. That is a literal term, that they are on the track team and all these guys can run and catch.
Terrence Williams wrestled down by Seth Adams, a true freshman getting into the game. 6-yard carry. And it'll be 4th and 8. And no, they're not punting. They're 2 for 3 on 4th downs. We're going to get a flag here.
False start. Offense, number 77. 5-yard penalty, 4th down.
So from 4th and 8 to 4th and 13. Patrick Lawrence.
Well, those are the growing pains for young offensive linemen. Patrick Lawrence comes in the game. You got to be game ready. Gave up a sack on Stidham, and now as they're trying to hurry up and catch Lamar off guard, he jumps off the line of scrimmage and moves his offense back 5 yards.
On fourth down, they hand it off. Terrence Williams has to get to the 26. And he got to the 23. First down, Baylor. He took Seth Ellis and Tommy Barrett along for the ride with him at the end of the run.
This game's already out of hand, but as a defense, it's got to be so deflating. It's a give-up run play. Just hoping to get something, run this clock out, and actually pick up the first down.
Terrence Williams now the third running back. Over 100 yards today for Baylor as he gets another one here for three more. Shock Linwood, 18 carries for 130 yards and three touchdowns. Johnny Jefferson, 12 carries, 121, and a touchdown. Terrence Williams is missing the touchdown, but 12 carries, 113 yards. Give him another carry and another couple of yards before he's upended by Josh Frost.
I think you'll get one. I think the way they're just going to give him the rock under 2 minutes is run this thing out. Lamar's exhausted. I think you're just going to keep handing the ball off. I know Terrence, he looks exhausted, but he'll get a touchdown.
Here he goes, powering through. It'll be close to a first down. And it will be for Baylor on the 15th play of the drive.
Well, now it's just a couple kneel downs and this thing's over.
Terrence Williams, he may not get it. He may need a breather. But he's not going to get one. Starting to wander towards the sidelines, but we'll hang in there. Baylor is off next week. It is their only off week of the season. 2 weeks, September 26th. We'll be back here for the game against Rice. And then, Big 12 the rest of the way. Trying to win their third straight Big 12 championship. Stiff! End zone! Touchdown! 13-yard run, the first rushing touchdown in the career of Jarrett Stidham.
Why? I don't get it. You know, I know you want to, you know, Stidham had a throwing touchdown last week on his very first play in college. Now he's got a rushing touchdown, but no, why do you need to do that? You got the first down. All you got to do is take a knee, get this thing over with. Lamar doesn't need another touchdown tacked onto him. I guess I don't really understand why you would do that in this situation.
Chris Callahan back out there. He has made all but one. It was a bad snap on the one they didn't convert. Made up for it with a two-point conversion. And so it is now 66 points on the board and 785 yards for Baylor. Prince player of the game. Four touchdowns for Corey Coleman. And they were pretty.
You know, 178 yards last week. Only one touchdown against SMU. Why not come back for 182 and four touchdowns tonight? You know, this is being nitpicky, but where I want to see him develop is running more complete routes. More, not just straight down the field speed type of routes. I want to see some in-cutting routes, some slant passes. Just bring a little bit more stuff to his game that shows that he can do everything. We all know that you're fast. You can run down the field, run past any corner in this league. But I think if he really wants to elevate his game, show that he can run the route tree, show that he can come out of breaks, because boy, he is fun to watch, and I hope that he can keep it up, because he's going to be one of the best to watch all season long.
Preseason all Big 12, he had 1,100 yards last year, didn't play in any of the non-conference games. All of those receiving yards were against Big 12 opponents. Here's Rodney Randall, and he took a hit at the 15-yard line. What a shot delivered there. Next weekend, we have more Big 12 football action on Fox Sports. Our coverage begins 3 p.m. Eastern, where our crew will be in Louisiana Tech taking on Kansas State. That game in Manhattan, following up at 8 p.m. Eastern with SMU facing number 3 TCU. Big winners today against Stephen F. Austin.
Well, I'm excited to see how Kenneth Dixon and La Tech, if they can run the football against Kansas State. Kansas State played really well on the road today, only allowed 3 points. But, you know, the storylines for next week is, you know, they've got Joe Huebner, a quarterback in Kansas State that made his first start ever in his career in high school and in college today. Their number one starter got hurt in the first game of the season, Jesse Ertz. So they've got a lot of issues, a lot of inexperience at the quarterback. And, you know, it's going to be a fun game. A lot of running the football, good defense. It's going to be fun.
It's a 7-yard carry for Keegan Mitchell. True freshman. and his first carry of the game here tonight. They'll give it to him again. Why not? He gets the first down as we're inside the final half minute of play. Pat Lovell's made the tackle. And so the Baylor Bears, who are coming out, we were thinking they were going to make a statement on defense after allowing 369 yards, 21 points last weekend to SMU. As Mitchell is dragged down inbounds. And that'll do it. Ben, your thoughts on their performance here today? They got it done, but wasn't pretty.
Well, the offense was kind of herky-jerky, but, you know, 700 plus yards. I mean, you can't complain about that. They have to take care of the football a little bit more if you're Seth Russell. And defensively, I don't know what's going on. They always need a first half to kind of figure things out. If they don't figure out how to stop the zone read and a running quarterback, they're going to have a long season defensively.
35-point win for the second week in a row, and that'll do it here from Waco, where Baylor takes down Lamar 66-31. Next week, more Big 12 football. Our coverage begins 3 Eastern, when we're seeing Louisiana Tech at Kansas State, and then at 8 p.m. Eastern, SMU faces number 3 TCU. For Ben Lieber and Christian Steckel, this is Brendan Burke. Thanks for watching. This has been a presentation of Fox College Football. Have a great rest of your weekend.